We like excited. We ready to get started?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right. Well, hello, everybody, and good morning. This is Ashley with Intermark Group. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar. This is our fifth webinar today on psychology marketing during the different phases of the pandemic. Today's webinar today is about getting back to business, balancing branding and sales for 2020, where we're going to discuss new changes in consumer psychology during what we're calling phase four of the pandemic. We're also going to share examples of effective marketing strategies like System One thinking, personal stories, the scarcity principle, as well as test and learn methods for connecting with customers right now. Our webinar speakers from Intermark are Jake McKenzie, Dr. David Bridwell, and Keith Otter. Jake is the CEO of Intermark and considered a national expert on psychology-driven marketing. He has a background in psychology and has helped shape successful brands such as Toyota, Krispy Kreme, Progressive Insurance, and more. He loves the outdoors. He's an avid reader and a father to four. Dr. David Bridwell is a people scientist at Intermark, also a folk musician by night. He's super interested in understanding how people are influenced and ultimately how they make decisions. At Intermark, he helps ensure our creative is informed by behavior science and uses applied psychology to help brands build deeper psychological connections with their customers. And finally, Keith Otter is our chief creative officer. He's a former pro soccer player turned advertising creative who has worked at some of advertising's top agencies and helped shape some of the world's biggest brands. And lastly, before we kick things off, please make note of a few house rules. There are really no rules, with the exception of we'd love to hear from you. So please share your questions with us in the Zoom QA function at the bottom of your screen. We'll try and answer all questions at the end of the webinar. And of course, we'd love to connect with you after the webinar to discuss your marketing needs. So now I'm going to turn it over to Jake, David, and Keith.
Thanks, Ashley. Good to be here again and see everybody, or rather be seen as the case may be. Every time we get ready to do one of these, we think we're going to take some of these threads and dive deeper into it. But then things change again. And we have seen yet another round of major changes in the last month since we did our last webinar. Is the only thing that stays constant is change. Some of the changes that we are seeing are kind of a regression against some of the reopening that we saw. And we're also seeing a lot of behaviors become cemented in and become permanent. And as anytime there's change, that presents opportunity and things we need to take into consideration when we talk marketing. So let's go ahead and dive in. As we always do, we'll start with a little bit about Intermark. If you're watching this, you're probably aware that Intermark is the nation's largest behavioral sciences driven marketing firm. And when I say behavioral sciences, I mean psychology, sociology, behavioral economics. And what we do is we take a very disciplined approach about applying those sciences to the marketing and advertising space. So our teams use it to develop a lot of kind of traditional ad-like objects that are just better informed to kind of get better outcomes. We've had the privilege of doing that with some of the biggest and most fun brands in America. The thing they all have in common is they have all achieved just outstanding results by applying these principles. So rather than kind of going into marketing and kind of guessing what's going to work, knowing what's going to work ahead of time, always has better outcomes. And the things that we produce are kind of traditional ad objects. So TV spots and radio spots and better websites and digital experiences. And the content has really become huge lately. And we do that across three offices scattered about the country. And we're, of course, headquartered here out of Birmingham, Alabama. So enough about us. Let's dive in and talk about what we're here to talk about today. As always, we're going to begin with a psychology update and really understand kind of what consumers are going through, what they're feeling, and how that's impacting our marketing. Then we're going to transition into marketing strategies, some new strategies that we're seeing become very effective during this period, and a few things we haven't talked about before. And then lastly, we want to spend a little bit of time talking about how to implement these strategies, kind of with a test and learn methodology, and some of those things that we're seeing outcoming. So as we begin taking a look what consumers are feeling. As always, we want to apply a psychological lens. You know, when we started this process, things were major turmoil, right? We've now called that period phase one. Phase one was kind of the new threat, where we had this period of, oh my goodness, this thing is coming. What do we all do? We entered into phase two, which was the quarantine phase, where most of the white collar jobs, we had to go home. Everybody else was trying to stay in as much as they could. Phase three was the last time we talked, where we entered into a period of reopening. Most of the southern states went in some stages of trying to reopen their economy. People started to get back out. We saw attitudes begin to change. And phase four is kind of a disintegration of the reopening, or the oops, that was a bit too soon. Now, anytime you see major change, you're going to see changes in attitudes and perceptions and how we consume information, and this is no different. This kind of touching the hot stove phenomenon and people pulling back, we think, is going to have some very long-lasting effects in not only behavior, but how we pursue information. And some of those changes are a little different than what we might expect in terms of how we perceive our own mortality.
Yeah. And, you know, one of the things is that we seem to have lost a sense of what phase we're even at. And that's this sort of disintegration. You know, in the very beginning, everybody was focused with what's going on with COVID. What is this new threat? Let me try to understand it. What does it mean for me? What does it mean for changes in my lifestyle? After we got a sense of what it is, and we sort of had some understanding of what to expect, then we reached a phase where we didn't necessarily have to hear about it anymore. And so we would see this information and we might even not want to hear it. We'd turn away to other things. And we basically got COVID fatigue. I think the notion that we as a society are not super focused on it is pretty apparent right now. We've sort of started to turn to some other things. And as we're doing that, as we're turning to other things, we're starting to experience a fragmented experience. So it's not the same experience across all of the people across the US or across the world. And a part of that is that the crisis is in a different stage in different places, and that affects our behavior. So for places that were showing an increase in cases, people were less likely to visit friends, they're less likely to go out into the salon and barber. But if for places that were showing a decrease in cases, people were more likely to go out and visit friends, more likely to visit a salon and a barber. So we're all experiencing different phases of the crisis throughout the US, which fragments us. And that experience is actually going to change with time. So it changes week by week, almost day to day. So there's a lot of things that are pulling us in different directions. But in general, we are noticing that there is an awareness that it's still present. There's been an uptick. So in later June, people are less likely to report wanting to go out to eat or wanting to go on vacation or going to a shopping mall. So as we become aware of the threat and periodically receive cues that it exists, that's going to have a big impact on our psychology. And that's one of the main things I'll be talking about today here. And what that means is that it creates an entry point. This is a marketing term, and it means that people are more likely to begin to experience new brands and to develop new habits. So this is something that happens when we become challenged or transform, or we experience a crisis, is that we can become open to new perspectives and experiences.
You know, and we talked about before that during this, people are more likely to try new things, try new brands, try new experiences. And we reported that 9 out of 10 people have self-reported that they have tried a new brand, tried a new store, done something they haven't done before. And one of the things that we're beginning to see is these changes, because this is lasting so long, are becoming permanent. There's a survey that came out yesterday that said 45% of people say that even post-pandemic, they won't eat out as much. They're going to cook at home more frequently. And so people are to the point where they are self-aware that some of these changes are becoming permanent. And that could include new brand relationships. And that's going to have some implications, some of our strategies that we talk about here in a moment.
Yeah, I think we've definitely entered that phase where people are kind of going on to the next thing. You know, that's mainly what we were just talking about. But one of the key psychological factors to consider going forward is the notion of mortality salience. And this is an actual psychological system that comes on board when we receive cues about our own mortality, and it becomes salient and prominent for us. So obviously we're going to be receiving a lot of these cues sporadically, and it brings up difficult feelings. It brings up these anxieties and this uncertainty that we have to deal with. And it turns out there are very specific psychological ways that we can deal with this anxiety related to these cues of our own mortality. So they basically buffer against it. So what you have is you've got this rising mortality salience cues that bring these anxious thoughts. And we need to have psychological thoughts that help to buffer and bring that down. And the studies have shown that in terms of an individual, some of the things that really help with this is creativity and forming meaning. So if you've previously thought that you're an artist, now is when people will be even more driven to go out and create some art so that their self-concept of themselves as an artist actually become true, and that helps to reinforce their identity, which helps make them feel like they're unique from the outside world, which is a crisis. So it actually buffers psychologically against these anxious feelings. Now that's at the individual level, but at the sort of group and societal level, this is going to manifest as the notion of identity reinforcement and forming social structures. So when you have this anxiety about mortality and related to this crisis, finding a social group is super important. And historically, that's always been super important because it's important for our survival. First, it helps us recognize who we are and helps us form an identity with our surroundings, but it also ensures that we have people that can help us nearby. So social structures are a big thing that are going to emerge to buffer, and it includes your local community, your family, it can include your country, your sports team, any sort of belief or group that sort of gets together and shares their thoughts about a common value and common things. Now, I talked about how our experiences are fragmented. This is the thing we need to understand about the customers and society right now. And the important thing is that mortality salience, these mortality cues, actually help to drive this fragmentation. Basically, people become more unique versions of their original selves. So for folks with low self-esteem, they, when they're exposed to mortality cues, they actually avoid novelty. But it's the opposite for folks who have high self-esteem. They become more open to novelty. So people who tend to stay home are even more likely to stay home right now. But people who seek novelty and seek to go out and experience things, they're actually more likely to go out and to strive to seek that novelty. So there's even more divergence.
And one of the big takeaways here is that the groups that we often use to profile against when we're marketing are now far more fragmented than they were before. So let's say we were targeting moms aged 28 to 41 before. Well, now that's no longer a homogenous group. Not only are they breaking apart geographically, but they're also breaking apart within that group in terms of their behavior set. So now more than ever, it's time to take a fresh look at our target groups and to reevaluate them psychologically because they are acting very differently than they were before. And most marketers are still relying on segmentation research that was done based off of surveys several years ago pre-COVID, and we're finding a lot of the assumptions based into those no longer hold true. So now's the time to take a fresh look at some of those things again.
Yeah, this is where, you know, psychological factors, psychographics can be very powerful. And in particular, you know, we see the importance of self-esteem mapping onto mortality salience here. And we don't have time to go over it. And just a reminder again, please put your questions in the bottom. But there's ways to try to look at self-esteem indirectly. And, you know, that's one of the things that we're very interested in, because it's not just the case that in the context of mortality salience that individuals feel anxiety and retreat. Some individuals with high self-esteem in particular have a boost in intelligence and a boost in working memory capacity in confronted with these cues, which I find fascinating. You know, since the beginning of this crisis, we've been talking about the notion of creativity and eccentricity. And this is going to be a really drawn out thing. It's not necessarily something we've seen right now with advertisements and commercials, but looking ahead 6 months and even years down the road, this experience might shape creativity and create new forms of art that because people are experiencing a crisis and this salience that they need to buffer through their own forms of creativity. And I think about Elvis Presley when I went to visit his childhood home, and Johnny Cash, I visited their childhood homes, and they went through this. You know, Oprah is another example. These people who have difficult upbringings who become really impactful. So one of the things that people are going to turn for is healthy behavior now. As this has gone on, this is something they can begin to focus on. And there's a specific demographic behind the folks that are going to look for healthy behavior, which is really important if you're in, you know, finance and insurance and healthcare industries right now.
And we predicted that at the very beginning of this, that we would see a boom in life insurance as kind of the cognitive dissonance around mortality was stripped away. And that has really happened. That industry is booming. We think the next major industry that's going to boom is this financial planning space. As people get into this healthy behavior area, they're going to reevaluate. And so we're going to see some financial institutions with real opportunities to have major growth amongst this segment with the appropriate outreach by doing some things differently. And so it's a good example of kind of the things that we are going through, not only fragmenting our experience, but changing our behaviors, and some of those behaviors having long-lasting, permanent, in some cases, consequences. So a recap of some of the principles that we have covered that still carry a lot of weight, things that are still resonating with people that we're just not going to spend a lot of time on today. Nostalgia, kind of that hearkening back to pre-pandemic times. Humor still resonates a lot because we're all stressed. The shared experience of the craziness that we are all going through. Reaching out, engaging our consumers, getting them active and doing something, offering something to them. Creating specific moments that are defined around your product or service that can relate to consumers are all examples of principles that we continue to see great success. A lot of brands are leveraging these concepts and putting out new work, new offerings to really connect with their consumers and see some growth. But we want to cover some things that we haven't spent a lot of time on, and one that we have spent some time on but is worth revisiting. So let's quickly recap the things we're going to talk about. The need to continue communicating with our consumers. We're going to talk a little bit about retention marketing. There have been a number of companies that have seen some growth, and that creates some new challenges in how you keep those folks. We're going to revisit System 1 marketing and how we convey information simply and effectively. We're going to talk about the need for personal stories in our marketing. And then lastly, we want to talk about this concept of scarcity. One of the things the pandemic has done is it's helped a lot of our clients and other businesses sell out of their products or just make it difficult to get things. And how do you take advantage of that in ways that can really elevate brand growth by leveraging a scarcity strategy? And we'll share some research around that. So let's start with number one, and the need to communicate. So if you're on this call, a whole lot of you at some point went away to college. And when you went away to college, if you're like I did, you just before you left, you met with all your high school friends, and you had that, oh, we're going to stay best friends forever. This is going to be great. I can't wait to reconnect. Well, then you got to college and you stopped communicating with those people, and they kind of faded into the background, and you formed new friends, and you kind of forgot about them, and you moved on. Well, the same thing is true in marketing. A lot of marketers have pulled back and stopped communicating, and they are those high school friends. And sometimes it's important to communicate, hey, I'm still here. Don't forget that we're still friends, because if you fail to do that, people will form new friendships, will form the new relationships, and that's what's going on. Affinity comes through repetition and staying in front of folks, and the research here is fairly overwhelming.
Yeah, don't be like that college friend that just disappears on you.
I think I was that college friend.
Although for the high school folks, I don't know, I'm not so sure about that.
Yeah, that's right.
But yeah, it's fascinating psychologically that simply seeing something repeatedly makes you have a positive impression of that thing. Even though it might not actually give you any positive return. And that's what the early studies have shown. If you show people Chinese characters or nonsense words between 1 and 25 times that they've seen it, every single time that they see it, they perceive the greater goodness of what that represents. And this is true even for random collections of letters of the alphabet that don't even form words. The more people see them, the more positively they view that thing, even though it's just, it doesn't even represent a word. It's basically just a symbol at that point. And so brands, that means that's how powerful it is to get your brand in front of somebody's face so that they see you. And a lot of times it can take a dozen or two dozen times for your advertisements to become impactful. But once you build a strong connection between your visual assets, like your logos and the characteristics of your brand, then you build associations between that very simple element and more complicated things like the logo and the name of the company. I know that's the power of the Geico Gecko here, is that you're scrolling on your phone, you only see things typically for 100, 200 milliseconds or so. But when you see that lizard, you get reminded of what product it is, and that 15 seconds could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
And it really has to do with how the brain stores information. Most people think that we store things in like a computer in these one little things and we can retrieve them. But the reality is we store information in blocks of interconnected information. And that's so that when we pull any bit of information, we pull everything around it. So that when you see the gecko, your brain immediately goes, okay, here's the name of the company. Here's their slogan about saving 15%. And maybe even pulling a creative spot that you like. So today is Wednesday, so you might be thinking about pump day.
Leslie, guess what today is?
It's hump day.
Woo-woo!
That still makes me laugh, man. And that's the power of being consistent and leveraging how memory works. It packages lots of things together. And so that repetition helps build that cluster of information. And that's where really powerful brands exist. And there's an overwhelming amount of research to show that if you are those new college friends and you're staying in front of folks and you're consistent with your character devices and your spots, you get much greater value than if you're changing your creative on a regular basis. And even in spite of this, we see people changing their campaigns, changing their approach on a regular basis, in spite of there being evidence this has a diminishing effect. And not only is consistency related to affinity, it relates to ROI. And you'll notice that even amongst the brand size, the folks at the top of this chart have consistent brand devices that they are constantly going back to, the same imagery, the same spokespeople, the same slogans. And that consistency is part of what drives affinity. And the lesson here is you want to be like the new college friends. You want to be the one staying in front of people and forming those new relationships. If you've turned off the spigot, if you've stopped communicating with your customers, then you are losing its efficacy and you're slowly going to lose your brand value as they form new friends. But during this period, we've also seen some new behaviors as people have tried new products. So some of our clients and a lot of CPG brands particularly have found some new customers. And that leads to the question, how do we take advantage of this? So we know that 9 out of 10 people have tried a new brand. They've gone to new stores, trying just all sorts of new opportunities. So you're seeing some churn in customers, and there's opportunity in that if you have a retention strategy. But this is a little different than normal marketing. How do we take advantage of this temporary diversion that has given your brand an opportunity to stand out? Maybe they initiate a trial, maybe they bought a pack of your widgets for the first time, or has given your service a try, or they're attending your webinar. Well, functions here are different than sales on the front end. When people are marketing on the front end, we're very big advocates of using system one, that kind of non-rational system. But when people buy a product, they rationalize that purchase after the fact as opposed to before the purchase. So it's only when my wife asks me, hey, why did you get this brand of bread, do I then look for a rational reason to explain why I got it. And the fact that it occurs post-purchase means marketing has to function slightly differently. We've got to talk to those customers and give them the reason that they bought or purchased to reinforce that reason. And this is really important for every type of purchase, but particularly for major purchases and B2B and service and things like that. But it can function down to the level of a simple food product. that could have been a spur of the moment opportunity. And there are a lot of ways to take advantage of this in our marketing, but marketing is going to be slightly different. It's not necessarily putting it in a TV spot. So we can do this in very simple ways. The simplest way is just, hey, email our new customers and say, hey, here's our product and here's the reason that you're going to love it. We can also communicate on the packaging itself. Now, we know some of the packaging will affect the point of purchase and the decision to purchase it, but a whole lot of the packaging only gets read after it's at home or later. So leveraging that space on your packaging to continue to communicate is an opportunity. And then lastly, of course, is social media. It's fairly easy to target those new customers on social media. So putting out messaging to them to remind them of why this purchase is a great idea is a great way to help cement that behavior where it becomes permanent. Because we want to keep those customers, not just for the rest of the year, but into 21 and 22 and well into the future, so that we are growing from there and we don't see a regression after the end of this period.
And a lot of this is about the fact that your new customers are going to experience your brand in a different way than your old, than your returning customers. So that's why packaging, email, retargeting can be so powerful.
A broad concept to take advantage of this, particularly if you're seeing some growth, is to leverage social proof as that point of rationalization. Because if lots of people are doing something, then it will seem like a really good idea. And it's a great way to reinforce a point of purchase. So if you are seeing growth, if you have experienced a new customer, communicating that is a really good way to help people rationalize after the fact, because it will make them feel good. Like, oh, I'm not the only one that thought this brand of milk was a good idea to bring home for my family. Lots of people are doing it. They're experiencing a whole lot of growth. And all of a sudden I've laid the psychological groundwork to become a regular permanent consumer of this new brand. And this applies in every space, including the B2B space. So if you're experiencing some growth, if you have some good social proof to put out there, make sure you leverage it in your messaging.
Yeah, well, I don't know about you, but I've been really struggling to keep my hair looking amazing during lockdown. Actually, looking at a few of you now, it looks like some of you are struggling too. But thanks for our friends at Dove. Please know that we're not alone. In their latest commercial, they're using this social proof to demonstrate no matter how bad your DIY lockdown haircut is, thanks to your products, their products, your hair will remain shiny, bright, and healthy. Just like my head, I suppose, really. Ooh.
Please, I'm helping.
This is like I'm Medusa, but all my snakes died.
Yes!
Ah, haircuts. That brings back some fond and very distant memories for me. Now, I think Dove has done some really great work during the pandemic and incorporated lots of these psychological insights really well into their communications and formed some really strong connections with their audience, even those who don't have any hair or use soap, I suppose, to that point.
And I love how they've baked in kind of these shared experiences, humor, all while giving you a good rationalization for after the fact that you're part of this new tribe and community. There's so much goodness baked into this concept.
I think that that commercial also gave me the social proof confidence to cut my own hair.
Yeah, I think you should, man. We're all looking forward to it. We'll get bigger attendance next time on the webinar if you just promise to cut your own hair. All right, let's talk a little bit more about system one and how we can leverage it. We really want to focus in this time around how we consume information, how we should package information so that it is most readily accepted by consumers. Now, remember, we don't like new information. We don't like data. We're bombarded with it. The brain is not attuned to storing it or using it. And so we develop these heuristics to help us process this information. Decide what's important, what do I need to keep, and what do I need to pass along? Now, there are a lot of lessons on how to do this well. We've covered some of those, keeping it simple, bake them into stories, convey it emotionally, and not oversell. Because the tendency for marketers is to want to put everything into every spot. Oh, we've got these 15 messaging points. We've got to get them all across. And that is a terrible idea, because what will happen is we don't store any of them. And so let's take a look at some examples of where people have baked in lots of information with simplicity, as well as some folks that tried to put in too much and then saw some failures.
And we're bombarded with over 8,000 advertising messages a day, all of them screaming out for our attention. So it's no surprise that those companies who have learned to adapt and communicate clearly and simply are the ones that have thrived. One such example is this company here, and boy, they've learned a lot over the years. If you haven't worked it out already, this company is Apple, and this is their original logo, and ouch. There's a lot going on here. I think that's Isaac Newton sitting underneath an apple tree. He's got his quill out. He's writing in his notebook, and there's an apple just dangling above his head, just about to fall. Then we've got some text around the edges, and then we've got like flourishes and crests. Wow, the designer really, really went to town on this one. But then if you compare that to what they have now, it's really simple, it's really graphic, and really iconic. It conveys a lot of information in a really brief amount of time. In fact, I'm sure we didn't even have to pop this logo up, as I'm sure you could automatically already picture it in your head. And I suppose that's the Steve Jobs effect in full swing. And this kind of thinking, you know, that Apple has, you know, carries on through into their advertising communications. They keep things really nice and simple. Like, for example, when they launch a new product, they could be tempted to fill this advert with lots of information, telling them how good the camera is, how good this is and that. But instead, they make a commercial that really appeals to this system one decision making. Now let's take a look. Simple piece of communication. Let's just have a look and break it down. And right from the start, they show what the product is. Then they build this anticipation throughout, showing beautiful shots of the product being unboxed. Using this kind of AMSR, it really stimulates the senses and creates a strong kind of almost primal craving for us for the product. Then they cap it off with this one simple tagline. And I hold it's very effective in the way that we process information. Now I want to take this and then compare and contrast it to another company that launched a product. This is Quibi, and they had a big launch during the Super Bowl. And there's a lot of information in this. I hope you're sitting down, because there's a lot to take in. Just sit back and prepare to have your brain explode.
Where's the car? Greg, where are you?
I'll be there in a Quibi.
A what?
A Quibi.
Less than 10 minutes.
Megan Stallion got punched. Megan Stallion got punched.
Quick bites, big stories. Quibi.
You what? Okay, well, first it starts off with these people in these masks, and oh, it's a bank robbery. Then hang on a minute, where's their getaway driver? And then he says, I'll be here in a Quibi, which apparently is 10 minutes. And then they're introducing this new show that's going to be on Quibi. We don't really know what that is. And then there's two taglines. And then to top it off, there's finally three more pieces of information. Watching this commercial made me feel like I was sitting some kind of like torturous memory exam. I think it's no surprise that despite a humongous amount of money being spent at the Super Bowl and the Academy Awards and elsewhere, it flopped really badly. Nobody could even remember the name or what it was for. Now 70% of the people asked think Quibi is in fact a food delivery service. Way too much information.
So simplifying information, not putting everything in, is smart in terms of how we process information, but it also has to do with how likely we are to accept that information. There's a concept called confirmation bias, where we look to reinforce things that we already think we know. So what happens is people look for information that they don't like. So you may list 10 things and they love 9 of them, but they'll focus on the one they don't like and argue against it. Oh, I'm not interested in a lot of extra memory. I've got plenty now. I never use it. We're soaring to the cloud. I don't need that upgrade, even though you gave me 9 other reasons. And it's yet another reason to be very wary of trying to jam in lots of submeshes within a spot. It is very counterintuitive to how System 1 processes information. And we see this because lots of people want to jam in everything, including the executives across the country. So what you're trying to do is become the intuitive choice, the thing that System 1 says, hey, do this. And that isn't always a rational exercise. It's not about laying out smart argumentation. It's about psychologically powerful concepts delivered in emotionally resonating ways.
Yeah, and that works for even for major purchases that we're making, like when we purchase automobiles. If you think back to which brands you choose, maybe you've just because maybe your family members have purchased that same brand. Or, you know, when I go out and buy a new phone, I just went out and bought the latest version of the Apple phone and didn't really put too much thought of it because it's intuitive and we're using these intuitive decision-making systems.
Another good way to deliver information to relate to people is through personal stories. Now, as we've talked about, we're all concerned and stressed. This mortality salience has made us more attuned to social structure. And in a period of unknown environment, we continue to look to other people to tell us how to act. And so stories are a great way to convey that information. So when somebody does something that you haven't heard for the first time, maybe somebody took a road trip, you want to know, well, how did it go? What was it like staying at a hotel or going out to a restaurant or being in a different town. And you're trying to glean information from all those things. And it's because we're hardwired for stories. So leaning into that is smart. And there's a crazy amount of data to help us illustrate that this is the case. And it's because we don't process information in data chunks. Rather, we try to relate them through existing constructs that we already have. So taking existing thoughts and concepts and seeing how things fit together. And stories are the unifying structure that brings all that together. We're hardwired for stories. And this is where we leverage in concepts like universal values and what our company stands for. I know a lot of you I had discussions around, well, how do we deal with the Black Lives Matter movement or other social movements that have cropped up in recent days. And all this fits together. But let's start with taking a look at how stories help us process information.
And when you look at this is super cool. It's a bank doing something that a bank wouldn't typically do. It really breaks those cliches and stands out for it. Now, Lloyd's realized that the language of banking is totally foreign to many people out there. They didn't get interest rates and all that other financial gobbledygook. So to make things far more human and relatable, they got a team of video artists, illustrators, and storytellers together and create this really cool graphic novel. It highlighted key life moments and related how banks could be really useful to them in understandable ways. It connected really well and stood out because it told a simple story in a really engaging, relatable way.
And I love this example because banks are notorious for using lingo like, hey, come get a HELOC, which is a home equity line of credit, rather than saying, would you like to expand your house and need some money for doing that? Putting language in ways that we routinely digest. And most financial industries, it's a sea of sameness. I can take the logos off of ads and swap them with everybody else, and the ads, for the most part, still work. And this is breaking those norms. This is using narratives to help convey things in a human language that normal people understand. Really well done.
Yeah, who wants a HELOC? That sounds like a sea monster.
Okay, David, you may want to put your fingers in your ears for a moment because you might not want to hear what I have to say. You see, not all stories have to be true, real-life stories. In fact, they could be silly and made up, even if it's just something as crazy as telling people how your cookies are dipped in fudge and made by elves in a tree. It's still an interesting personal story that shifts the way we process information. And that's because the brain is hardwired for these narratives and cookies, I suppose. Okay, David, you can take your fingers out now. Like I was saying to everyone, Keebler cookies are made by real magical elves in real magical trees. And for all good boys and good girls and people scientists, that's their reward.
Good. I got worried there for a second.
My five-year-old let me know that a tree is a terrible place to put a bakery because it's probably a fire hazard.
And these stories can make great campaigns too. Coors Light may built this campaign around the story of a 63-year-old woman called Olive Verosi who put up a sign in her window saying that she needed more beer. Well, couldn't we all? Anyway, the news sparked across the internet. Coors picked it up and sent her 150 cans to make her feel better. And I'm sure when she wakes up, she'll agree that it certainly did. But then they continued to build this story and they gave away 500,000 beers to anyone who tweeted and let people know why they could use a beer right now. It was hugely successful. But again, it was built around this narrative. That reminds me, I just need to put this sign up in my window if there's anybody out there watching. Any gifts will be greatly accepted.
That's hilarious.
You forgot the hashtag.
Narratives not only help us convey our stories, they help us with lots of things, including promotion. So we look back to the last pandemic, GM was struggling to sell cars. They kept discounting the cars. And as we predicted, increasingly diminishing returns as you know financial incentives kind of fade. But what they found is that they could repackage those same incentives in a different narrative. So the narrative in this case was we're going to give people the same discount employees get. In some cases, the discounts were worse than what they were offering before, but sales went through the roof. And it was because packaging things within a narrative gives people a construct to digest it, and it had a lot more power for them. So everything functions within a narrative. So your brand story, your promotions, but it's also about your brand purpose. Now, we get a lot of questions of things like Black Lives Matter and other social promotions, and what do we do? And what I often say is don't ask the agency what to say, ask your company what you believe, ask yourself what you believe, what matters to you, because understanding your brand purpose ought not to be driven solely from a marketing standpoint, but something that your company truly values. And that will give you a roadmap for knowing when and how to express yourself. Now, there have been a lot of great examples of these. Perhaps the most famous is the Nike ad with Colin Kaepernick. They did this a little over a year ago, got huge blowback. The president himself spoke out against it. And man, did this ad age well. Nike sales actually went up in the near term because millennials really resonated with this. But wearing their brand purpose on their sleeve worked out really well for them. And their brand equity is at an all-time high as everybody looks back and applauds them for the courage that they had during this period. But it doesn't solely have to be around things that are controversial. It can merely be around things that value to you, including if you don't think they're that important. So Blue Cross Blue Shield of Alabama, their entire history have been very pro doctors and healthcare providers and making sure they always had the best and giving them a lot of support. Well, during the pandemic, that all of a sudden rose to the level where everyone shared that value. And merely by reminding people of how long they've held this value allowed them to raise their affinity levels.
Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Alabama wants to recognize all healthcare professionals, first responders, and those on the front lines battling COVID-19. Your sacrifice is truly inspiring.
So let's figure out what our brand purpose is, the things that matter to us as a company, and everybody's got them, and go ahead and get ready to bake it into your marketing using narratives. And that's the appropriate way to use language and social activism and to be upfront about it, to let people know what matters to you. Because we're projecting that values of social values are going to be elevated amongst consumers for quite a while. People are going to care what you care about and that activities that you're involved with. So go ahead and be ready to put it out and be forthright about it. Last principle is around scarcity. A lot of our clients have done well. Some of them had done so well, they're worried about having a negative brand experience when somebody goes to the store or goes to purchase their product and they can't get them. And I've heard that story, if you will, a number of times. Well, so we wanted to share some of the research around scarcity. Now, what we know around scarcity, when somebody goes to get your product and can't get it, it doesn't create a negative brand experience. In fact, it's quite the opposite. It dramatically elevates affinity. We want the things that we can't have. And we also know from research that this effect is very long lasting. Not being able to get a product once or twice creates huge demand that can last for years. And there's some really famous examples around this, as well as some fun research.
One of the original studies that came out showing about the scarcity principle involved giving people the option of choosing between a jar that contained just 2 cookies inside or a jar that contained 10 cookies inside. And when people know that there's fewer cookies inside, then they perceive those cookies as being more likable and they're actually willing to pay more. That's super interesting because it's the exact same thing. It's the same cookie either way. Simply the amount actually changes the way we process that information. Now, one of the really interesting things of this study is that particularly when people know that the scarcity is due to a high demand, it further boosts the amount that people are willing to pay. So 43% increase in the amount. And this is really interesting because, you know, we've been talking about the importance of embedding stories. And this is basically, if you can create a story around why your product is scarce, that can help communicate why it's scarce. And in particularly, if that story is surrounded by high demand, if it has that social proof aspect to it, then it can be even more powerful.
That's exactly right. And it's because the concept of scarcity functions on a precognitive level. It's really deep in the old brainstem that we're hardwired to want things that we can't have. One of my favorite case studies had to do when Coca-Cola was being overtaken by Pepsi. And we kind of forget those days during the Pepsi challenge, but market share wise, Pepsi was on the cusp of overtaking Coke as the dominant player. Well, Coke decided to respond by changing the formula. They rolled out new Coke and announced they're getting rid of old Coke. Well, we all know how it played out. People panicked. What do you mean I can't get old Coke anymore? And stores started to sell out as they sold down. Well, a black market formed, and all of a sudden a 2-liter bottle of Coke was going for over $100 on the black market. This is back in the 80s. So huge demand spikes. Well, Coke, of course, changed their mind, rolled out the old formula, and eventually punted the new formula entirely, even though it tasted superior. Now, what has happened long-term, Coke has dramatically widened the gap. Now, on a rational level, nothing changed. Same 2 competitors selling the same product, and Pepsi still maintained a win share in taste profile, like it tasted better to most consumers. But it was the scarcity piece that dramatically created brand elevation for Coke, and it has lasted for decades. They're now dominant in this space, and Pepsi continues to struggle to regain the sort of momentum that they used to have. Great concept for scarcity. And the lesson here is, if you have scarcity, you ought to view it as an opportunity. Leverage that opportunity to communicate that there is scarcity. It doesn't hurt brand value. It can dramatically create affinity. And you don't have to beat people over the head with, I can't get this. You can do it in more subtle ways.
Yeah, and I think it certainly helps when you've got something as delicious as KFC to sell. Here they're going to demonstrate the scarcity of their tasty chicken by showing the alternative consequences of not being able to get out and buy it yourself. Forgive me, I'm drooling a little bit. Scarcity certainly works. I'm already craving some of that tasty chicken right now. It's not too early, is it?
We're hardwired for the things that we can't have. Now, I'm not advocating actually pulling your products off your shelf, but when somebody can't get your product, yes, they will try competitors' products if they really need it, but it suffers brand affinity when they do so because they feel like they're settling, and it ultimately elevates your brand affinity. So don't miss the opportunity. Lastly, we get asked a whole lot, how do we apply some of these lessons? And the answer is to test and learn, to try new mediums, new messaging, try some of these things that we have talked about over the last several months, and then to understand how they work in different mediums, and then to gauge those effects and scale. Now, the concept of test and learn doesn't need to be explained, but we want to encourage you to look at it a little more broadly in terms of how it can be applied, because there are some new mediums that we rarely hear marketers talk about.
Yeah, there's a great opportunity, you know, to look at some of these new mediums. For example, the game Animal Crossing is really huge right now, and the good people at Sentosa Island, which is a resort just off the coast of Singapore, have taken advantage of that. Basically, they hacked into the game and recreated their own version of the island within it, which allowed gamers from around the world to experience and enjoy the same relaxation, fun and games from the island while playing at home during lockdown. So while they're not only garnering great PR and news attention from around the world, they're already prepping thousands of people to think about them when they're planning their next trip. And you talk about things taking off since the pandemic. If it was possible, TikTok has got even more popular now. They've got nearly 8 billion users globally. And it's not just young, modern, irreverent brands that are advertising their product on TikTok. Sometimes we've got super serious, sophisticated high-end brands like Uffizi Art Museum here in Florence are also reaching this new audience by using this short video format to woo and educate new guests.
One of our clients, Troy University, we encouraged to try a new medium and to leverage some of our prior principles of like engaging their audience. So they decided to offer a free online course around leadership over the summer to try to take advantage of everybody's downtime and working from home. And we pushed this almost entirely with social media was the heart of the promotion. So that was kind of a new medium for them. And it was wildly successful. So over 150 million people have been reached by PR alone, almost 50,000 new unique visitors to the website to evaluate Troy in the new course, and we're approaching 5,000 registered users for this course. And we're already beginning to see several hundred of those folks indicate they want to continue on, and so we're anticipating great things. A great example of trying something new, both in terms of a message, an offering, and a medium, and achieving some spectacular results. A lot of new mediums out there to try, but there are also some lessons to not do. So you may have heard, saw this in the news, but Chuck E. Cheese did not do well during the pandemic because nobody wants to go to a common play area. And nobody was ordering pizza to be delivered from Chuck E. Cheese, even via, you know, Uber Eats and things like that. So they decided to launch a new sub-brand, Pasquale's Pizza and Wings. And it was the same food offered at Chuck E. Cheese in the same kitchens, just under a different brand. And they got blowback from it. People felt like it was a bait and switch. It has hurt the brand reputation for Chuck E. Cheese and make people think that their pizza is even worse than it was perceived before. And it's a good example of abandoning a brand that you have, because at best you start from zero. And in some cases you can hurt yourself. So the lesson here is to continue to be consistent in your messaging and brand approach and packages and spokespeople, because we're all looking for those points of consistency, but to still try new approaches, tweaks in your messages, tweaks in your medium are the way to go about this, not a wholesale change in your overall approach. So if you got something that's working, continue to do it, continue to communicate.
Yeah, be careful if you're gonna take your, you know, beloved brand spokesperson and throw them off a cliff into a burning vehicle.
Okay. A lot of folks concerned about that. So we've covered today kind of another shift in the psychology of consumers. We're getting a lot more fragmentation. We talked about some of the marketing strategies that we need to begin incorporating. Got to continue to communicate. You want to be the new college friends that are talking to people and not the high school friends that just stop talking. New focus on retention marketing and some of the changes that you can tweak your messaging there. Focus on system one marketing, simplifying your messaging so that people can digest it better, bake in more personal stories. And when you have an opportunity to communicate scarcity, because it's a great, easy way to get dramatic brand elevation that's low risk, low cost. And then let's do some testing and learning of all of these things to continue trying some new efforts. For more great psychology-driven information, visit us on our website or on any of our social media channels. A lot more videos and contents out there, and we'll continue doing regular webinars. If you have questions, we're going to take a couple here at the end. If I don't get to them, I will respond to you directly. Feel free to email me directly. I'm happy to talk about this at any time. I clearly love talking about it. Or email Ashley, and we can schedule some time to really dive in on your products or services and help you out specifically. So in our last couple of minutes, let's answer a couple of the questions that have come through. Let's see. The first question that we got was about applying a lot of these in a B2B scenario. What we remind everybody is that you're talking to humans, and humans process information the same way, regardless of if they are a business consumer or a purchasing for themselves at home, that we still have the same processing and decision-making systems in the brain. So all the lessons still apply. They may manifest themselves a little differently. You may use different mediums to get this across, but all the lessons still apply. In fact, we've seen some very successful B2B companies applying these lessons and getting some tremendous results, because at the end of the day, you're still marketing to humans. They just have less concern about how it affects them personally and more perceptually within their workplace. It's about the only major variable that changes there.
And we talked about system two. That's one of the things that kind of gets a little bit more important in the B2B scenario, where you might need to provide some figures and really make sure that they can rationalize why you're the best choice. But it is, you always have to satisfy system one intuition first, and then consider that how they can articulate and rationalize the decision that they made.
Well, I've got a question about how the changes with kind of the social causes, Black Lives Matter and some of the other social causes that are going to pop up, how are they going to affect marketing? We've touched on that a little bit today. We're probably going to put out some additional content about that in the coming weeks. These are going to stick around, perhaps not the specific causes, although I expect Black Lives Matter and the fairness with which we treat people of color are going to stick around for a while. But just people's awareness around causes and how companies are expressing themselves and what causes matter to companies are probably going to be elevated for quite a while. So if you haven't expressed what matters to your company and baked it into your marketing, get ready to, because people are going to begin asking in ways that they haven't before.
And one of the reasons we emphasize storytelling here is because we want to see people communicating about those causes through storytelling. And that's the most powerful way to do that. And so you really need to keep that in mind as you do that.
Great. Well, we are out of time today. Thank you so much for everybody that attended. Enjoy this so much. We will post the video no later than tomorrow, so you'll be able to download it. And we look forward to seeing you guys next time. If you have any questions, shoot me an email. Talk with you soon.